A young Felix Adler founded this community in 1876, and the first generation of members dedicated this building adjacent to the Echo Culture School in 1910. For 140 years, we have welcomed people who choose to put ethics at the center of their lives. Whatever you believe or disbelieve, we hope that you will find a home here on the common ground of ethics. My name is Ann Gleason. I'm one of the leaders here, and it's always a pleasure to welcome you to my home. Our ancestors extended this common ground of ethics far beyond New York City to include the international arena. It fell to many of the women of ethical culture to do that. In fact, two of our ethical culturists, Jane Addams and Anna Garland Spencer, were among the over 1,100 women who came together in 1915 in The Hague from a diversity of cultures and languages during the First World War to study, make known, and eliminate the root causes of war. They sent delegates from both sides of the conflict to countries on the opposite sides, and they created the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. In 1947, the National Women's Conference, affiliated with the United Nations, as the first humanist group to enter into formal association with the Department of Public Information at the United Nations. Under the name of the National Ethical Service, it continues to promote peace, care of the environment, and human rights. Rose Walker, who for many years led our NGO, the National Ethical Service, once said that if ethical culture had a sacred text, it would be the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights, adopted by the General Assembly on December 10, 1948. You may have noticed when you entered the lobby that a copy of this document hangs there, alongside a portrait of Eleanor Roosevelt. It is indeed something we consider a sacred text. And we admire not only Mrs. Roosevelt for her work here at the Ethical Culture Society and in founding the Encampment for Citizenship, but also honor the way that she worked on a process to bring people together. And that process continues today at the United Nations. The result of the presidential election confirmed what we have known for years, that a significant number of American voters do not believe, as we do, that human rights must be universal, and that every one of us shares the responsibility to make that a reality. So it is with particular pleasure and honor and privilege that I introduce to you someone I'm sure all of you know already, nonetheless, Jeffrey Sachs, who has worked both at the Earth Institute at Columbia University, but also with the United Nations in developing the Millennial Development Goals and now on the Sustainable Development Goals. Jeff.
Job of Secretary General, I think, objective. speaking, it's the toughest job in the world. Everything will seem easy after this. Every problem in the world comes to the Secretary General. And you might think being President of the United States is challenging. We'll find out if it is. Being Secretary General is like that 193 times, because every country, every issue around the world, every conflict, every aspiration in the world is uniquely in the hands of the Secretary General. And on many occasions, when I traveled with the Secretary General and his delegation to a G20 meeting or a summit meeting of some kind, somewhere between 7 in the evening and 7 in the morning, the list of problems that has accrued overnight, the number of cables, the number of phone calls that the Secretary General had to make to try to unlock or unblock some kind of global emergency, or to send a response team to a new disaster area, or to handle a sudden flashpoint in the world, is absolutely extraordinary. And SG, I only want to share my profound, unbounded admiration for you, because I've watched for 10 years a person of incredible integrity, incredible hard work, great sense of humor, always able to manage under remarkable pressures, and get us to where we are this evening. Where we are this evening is at a kind of watershed for the world, and that's our subject this evening. And that is that under the Secretary General's lead, and because of the realities that we face in the world, the whole world community, which is very fractious, very divided, very difficult, very complicated, agreed twice at the end of 2015 on remarkably far-reaching, important, shared world objectives. The first agreement was on September 25th, 2015, when all 193 member states of the United Nations came together to set a shared agenda for 2030 on the common theme of sustainable development. And within that agenda, very bold and very visionary, are 17 sustainable development goals, which really bring us here this evening and will bring us back, as I'll describe later, for this coming year, because we are a community that needs to put these goals into operation. Just a few weeks after that agreement was reached, another momentous achievement was made, and also beyond any expectation, because UN processes are very complex and climate negotiations are even more complex than normal UN processes. Any single one of the 196 signatories to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change could have stood up in Paris in December of 2015 and said, "I object," and I'm not sure what your backup plan was, but it would not have been a very easy circumstance at all. And yet, just a few weeks after the Sustainable Development Goals were reached, all 196 signatories signed the Paris Climate Agreement. And these two accomplishments are historic accomplishments. They were years in the making. Thousands of phone calls by the Secretary General, countless meetings, countless gatherings at the United Nations headquarters, head of state conferences, strategizing. And these two achievements are historic. And for that, we want to thank you, Secretary General. You have set the path for us for the coming generation, and we're profoundly grateful, and I want to. It's given on behalf of Ethics in Action for Sustainable and Integral Development by Bishop Marcelo Sanchez Sorondo, and I'm lucky to have my name on the document also, Secretary General.
Thank you, Professor Jeffrey Sachs, an honorable intellectual singer, president of New York Society for Ethical Culture, distinguished guest ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to join you this evening, and I thank New York Society for Ethical Culture for hosting this gathering. Professor Sachs, I'd like to express my deep thanks and for the Ethics in Action Award. I know it's not just me who you are recognizing, and I will humbly accept this award on behalf of tens of thousands of UN staff who are working day and night all around the world for human dignity and to protect the human rights, and also to save many, many people who otherwise would be dying or whose human rights and dignity would be violated. And again, thank you for this recognition, and thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm also very much moved to hear the special message from His Holiness Pope Francis. One of the highlights of my tenure was hosting Pope Francis last year at UN headquarters. Popes have visited before the United Nations, but never during the high-level session of the General Assembly of the United Nations. Since he was inaugurated as a Pope, I have been meeting him 5 times already in just 3 years. So you may not see how many world leaders have been meeting him 5 times in 3 years since he became the Pope. That much he and I have been working very closely to make sure that climate change is agreed and sustainable development will deliver human dignity and all these necessary things for many people around the world. The Pope's presence was especially notable for coinciding with the adoption of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. That was the main purpose and main occasion when more than 150 world's leaders, President and Prime Ministers were gathered, including President Obama. We invited Pope Francis, and he delivered a very strong, of course, a visionary statement for humanity. And I really appreciate it. He's particularly, as Professor Sachs mentioned, his encyclical on climate change, which was it issued June last year, was critically important. It really pushed very hard the minds of people who are still reluctant to agree to this climate change agreement. Last year's Vatican meeting, again, on the moral dimension of climate change and sustainable development was a further contribution. And just this week, His Holiness spoke again about the ethical and moral dimension of climate change and urged world leaders to put global environmental agreements into effect as soon as possible. Ethics are built right into the ideas and objectives of the United Nations. A commitment for human rights is part of our identity. The human rights is one of the three pillars of the United Nations Charter, peace and security, and development and human rights. Those are three pillars, equally important, but as a Secretary General, I made it clear that among these three, human rights should be upfronted. I declared in 2013 and launched a human rights upfront initiatives because we have learned in the past some hard lessons, very tragic lessons, that human rights and human dignity of people have not been properly protected and human lives were lost. So I made it quite clear that while human rights priority has been there during the last 70 years, I thought that this should always be given the top priority and upfronted all the times. This is what we call it, human rights upfront policies. The day in and day out, we promote tolerance and mutual understanding. The 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development itself is rooted in ethics. It aims to end inequality. The enjoyment of great plenty by some alongside widespread deprivation for others is not just an economic fact and social phenomenon. It is an ethical tragedy. The agenda also seeks to safeguard our planet. It is unethical to undermine livelihoods and living standards through the plunder of the world's natural resources. Averting a future of climate chaos is a moral imperative of the first order. Those who suffer first and worst from climate impact are those, in fact, who have contributed least to the climate phenomenon, like the countries and small island developing countries in South Pacific and Caribbean. There are many small countries whose survival is a real problem. Some leaders are saying that one day they suddenly cannot see the island, which they have been seeing all the times. Like an island, a small island in South Pacific, Kiribati, I've been there. And if you go there, when you drive a car, the road is always under shallow water. So they're always fresh, because depending upon the moonlight, it goes up to 60 centimeters high above water, above the ground. That island has the highest point is 3 meters high above sea level. So everything is almost under the sea level. So the report says that they are now they have bought some land in Fiji, and they are now trying to have environmental refugee status in New Zealand and Australia. This is a very serious issue. Therefore, their voices have been loudly heard, which really helped in pushing world leaders to agree to climate change. The United Nations also faces many ethical dilemmas. In some cases, in the search of peace, we have to speak with those who wage war. Our humanitarian operations help millions of people every day, yet are unable to reach all those in need. In Syria, still, there are millions of people who are living in besieged areas or hard-to-reach areas. These are, again, injustice and unethical, when we are not able to do anything because of a very dire security situation. Often, international community is divided and paralyzed, and thereby abandoning people caught up in conflict and disaster. For the past decade, I have sought to strengthen the ethical dimensions of our work. This is especially important at this time of divisiveness, when extremist groups and even many political leaders seem intent on pushing people into camps of us and them, or you and me. I have been urging leaders of the world, you have seen what has been happening in Europe, then please do not erect walls. Let us build the bridges between and among the people, rather than erecting walls. This is not what political leaders should do. The 2030 Agenda is not only our shared manifesto, but also a platform for cooperation. The same is true of the Paris Agreement. Together we can improve lives and strengthen the ethical and other bonds that link all societies in a profoundly interdependent world. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for this recognition, and I'm very much honored. And as I prepare to retire from this job and hand over all this, one of the most impossible jobs, to my successor, Antonio Guterres, I trust you will give him a strong support and will work with my successor even more closely, as you have been doing with me and the United Nations. And I thank you very much, and even though I may soon join in your group, like the civil society, the peace and security, human rights, and all sustainable development, have already been embedded in my body, it's in my DNA, so I will work with you to make this world better, healthier, more prosperous, more peaceful for everybody of the world. I thank you very much. Thank you.
Finally, for the first time ever, at least have an agreement on the basic strategy forward. I wanted to ask you in that regard a few things for our guidance also. And you mentioned the first point, and that is the question of why it seems that the tensions on globalization are rising so significantly, and all of these nationalist pressures. From your perspective, since you've seen almost every country in the world, you've spoken to every leader, and now we have this backlash underway, do you have some thoughts about what is going to be the most effective way to overcome what seems to be a rolling backlash right now, and how we're going to make sure that leaders follow the direction that you've indicated? I thought it was fair that we're going to ask all questions about the incoming president for your successor. So this is not a question about the election in the United States, but a more general question what you think we can do to strengthen the commitment to the international norms and to overcome what seem to be growing pressures of nationalism and localism.
In the course of globalization, I think mostly there have been a lot of positive things for our lives. But in the course of all this deepening globalization, with a lot of movement of people, and particularly with the growing number of crises, violences happening here and there. For example, the crisis in Syria, which has been continuing 6 years. Then in Yemen, the South Sudan, Central African Republic, Libya, etc., etc. I think the many people have to flee their homes, flee their countries forcibly. This kind of situation has caused a lot of divides. At first, the people have been very kind, and they have shown some solidarity, and they have shown compassionate leadership. And when the number of refugees and displaced persons reached more than 60 million people, now we have 65 million people, that's the highest number of people since the end of Second World War. Only during Second World War, we have had that many refugees. Then clearly we see lack of compassion, lack of solidarity, global solidarity. Even in 2010, when there was a huge tragic earthquake in Haiti, many people just showed their leadership and solidarity. A lot of money were mobilized in just one day. But after that, with all these Arab Springs, which started in a positive way, but has been met with some leaders who have been just crushing the will of the people, then this kind of has created some grievances among people, and people have been fighting against the people, then this created crisis in many, many parts of the world. Even under such circumstances, while nationalisms are mounting and there are political rhetorics by political leaders who are inciting and provoking nationalism, and just among themselves, I think if we have a global solidarity, if we have a compassionate leadership, knowing that we are living in a small world after all. The people living, moving from this place to another place, I think they are not going anywhere. And they are living in this world. So the burden has been moved to another country. Then this country will have another problem, while you may have a lesser problem, but this will come back to you. So we should know that And if we show our solidarity, global solidarity, then we will be able to lessen and reduce the nationalism, and the very parochial regionalism. I have been urging member states, as I said, that let us build the bridges so that people can freely move around rather than erecting walls. That has been my message. Then more seriously, this kind of very difficult situations where many people have been harboring their grievances in their heart against the government, it has given some perfect ground for extremists and terrorists take roots among people. So we have to be very seriously addressing these issues altogether. Not a single country can do this. United States, however powerful, the richest and most powerful country, cannot do it alone. United Nations cannot do it alone when there is no solidarity. So we have to show some strong solidarity for humanity.
Thank you very much. Can I ask you, I know that your time is short, so we will respect that. One more question, which is that you've been Secretary General 9 years, 11 months, and one month to go. And I think all of us feel you've proved again and again that the United Nations is the unique and indispensable institution globally for global cooperation, the only place where it's conceivable to have an agreement on climate, or the only place that it's conceivable to have an agreement on human rights. What could you tell us about the most important ways that the UN should be strengthened and renewed in the coming years? What are the biggest challenges and ways and areas where we should support the UN or insist on international support for the UN in particular ways so that the United Nations can perform its services in the most effective manner?
I'm conscious of some criticisms about the United Nations effectiveness and efficiencies. As Professor Sachs said, we have 193 member states. When the UN was founded 71 years ago, there were only 51 member states. Now it has gone maybe four times in terms of member states. In terms of the number of crises, I think it has, with the globalization and with the people's movement all around the world, the number of crises, number of problems have again exponentially increased. And therefore, it is only natural that we have seen so many problems and people have not been happy with what the United Nations has been doing. Having said that, when you think that there are 193 member states, that means we have 193 board members in one company. You may know well that however big company, global company, there are not as many 193 board members in boardrooms. There's a CEO and some very effectively working board members, 20, 25, or 30, not 193. Well, the problem is that all these 193 board members, they seem to believe that everybody is the chairman of this board. Because they claim that we are sovereign state. So sovereignty, that is most important principle which we have to respect. But when the member state discuss in the United Nations, this is a universal international organization, then they should not too much insist on their national interest. They should talk about the global visions, like sustainable development goals, climate change issues, gender empowerment issues, and human rights, human dignity, how to reduce this injustice, how to eradicate impunity, and how to eradicate poverty, and how to help those people living with the physical disabilities, how to enhance the human rights of indigenous rural people, etc., etc. But in most cases, they bring their very narrow perspective of national interest. National interest. Sometimes this makes Security Council paralyzed. Ineffectiveness. We've been trying to reform, we've been trying to change the work of the United Nations. Unfortunately, sometimes it seems that we have an inherent problems, inherent structural problems. That's why during the last 10 years, I have been asking and doing a lot to reform the UN's way of working. The one is that let's work as one United Nations. We have so many different agencies and funds and programs and secretariat. We have at least 16 specialized agencies where member states are all different, funding are all different, and we have many funds and programs. They are almost autonomous, even though I appoint them. I appoint heads of all these funds and programs. Since day one, I said I initiated delivering as one system, DAO, delivering as one. One United Nations, think as one, act as one, and deliver as one. This has been very much well established now. And I have been convening twice a year, inviting all the heads of specialized agencies and funds and programs. All these heads of, we've been meeting together and trying to make sure that whole UN system work as one team. I've been telling them that even though I do not have a direct authority to ask them to do this and that, for example, let's make sure that while we drive our car in an expressway, there are four or five lanes. Some cars, some drivers, they can drive for 60, 70 miles, or some people may drive 50 miles, but that's fine, unless we go toward the same direction, unless we don't violate the traffic rules like going against this opposite lane or breaking this, the solid yellow lanes. You are free to drive at a comfortable speed. But let's make sure that we don't make any accident and we go toward the same direction. That's a philosophical thinking of the United Nations, and we have been doing during the last 10 years. Of course, there are many areas to improve. And the decision-making process is problematic sometimes. There is clearly some misunderstandings, misperception that consensus is identified with unanimity. When 193 member states are there, it is extremely difficult to achieve unanimity. We say that let's decide on consensus. Consensus means that whether there are five or six countries who may have different views, when most of them agree on one thing, then all these people should not block. I mean, for example, any well-functioning company, one or two board members try to block any decision of the CEO. Then at the same time, most of the companies, when CEO decides, it's done. Then CEO will be responsible when they do not make a profit at the end of the year, so they can be replaced. But here, absolutely, if you have to ensure that there is always a consensus, then you cannot function. I have been asking Security Council all the times, why I cannot challenge about veto power? That's a charter provision, so I cannot change unless you amend Charter of the United Nations. But whatever may happen, very seriously tragic things happen, when Security Council issues a statement, there are presidential statement, press statement, all 15 member states have to agree without exception of any country. So one country can blow this decision. Then Security Council is paralyzed. Then why many people have been killed in the secret and Syria and elsewhere, sometimes they cannot even condemn. It has been me, as a Secretary General, I have always been condemned. I have no such things. When I decide, I can issue, I can speak out. But when the General Assembly or Security Council, when they have to make a consensus decision, it takes time. For example, when North Korea detonated nuclear weapons, then still sometimes they cannot say anything. It takes sometimes 1 month or 2 months to say something. Then one cannot have a problem. That's what I have been urging as a Secretary General. We have to change this decision-making process. Of course, I should not be too much critical about the organization in which I have been working, and I have been really trying to change this. I have changed a lot, but still, decision-making process should be changed. That's one thing. As an outgoing Secretary General, I have become a little bit more vocal now. That's one thing which I can tell
you. Thank you very much. Because we're going to have a little bit of a discussion about our coming program together. But please stand and join me again. Your colleagues and your friends, because we have an important agenda, an important agenda for the coming year and for the coming years. And that is that we are obviously in a very complicated moment in our country and in the world. On the one hand, we have an exciting, positive, creative, crucial agenda of sustainable development, meaning a universal agenda to combine our economic aspirations with social justice and with environmental sustainability. On the other hand, as you just heard, the world often seems to be pulling itself apart at the seams, and even, of course, our own society is like that. I was reminded, by the way, by the Secretary General's remarks about the need for consensus, that when Kofi Annan was Secretary General, he had been in for about 6 months, and one very influential foreign minister criticized him quite sharply and said, "You know, you've been here 6 months and nothing much has happened. It took the Lord only 6 days to make the world, and then he could rest." And Kofi Annan immediately shot back and said, "Yes, but the good Lord did not have 193 member states on his board." And the notion of getting consensus is really an essential challenge. That's why we're here. That's what Ethics in Action hopes to do. We're in a great hall, in an esteemed place. And I want to introduce you to three friends. The friend on the right is Felix Adler, who established the Ethical Culture Society, which we're in this great hall. And his opening speech, as you heard from Ann Clayton at the beginning of the program, was exactly 140 years ago. And he said that for New York City and our then newly industrialized society to be able to address its challenges, we have to put ethics at the core of the challenge. Well, the two gentlemen on the left, I hope you recognize them. On the far left, you have Plato, and the next is Aristotle. That's from my all-time favorite picture of the School of Athens, which is in Raphael's stanza, just in the Vatican. And it is, in my view, the greatest monument to Western civilization that we have. But we are 2,365 years celebration of the anniversary of the birth of political science, when Aristotle published The Politics. And Aristotle said in The Politics that we are social animals, and that our job to reach our highest level of well-being is to learn how to live properly with each other by pursuing our virtues and pursuing our excellence. And it's the spirit of Aristotle and the spirit of Felix Adler which bring us to our occasion this year, a series that we're inaugurating this evening with Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. You can't do better than that to inaugurate this, where we aim to bring together the greater New York community. Now, many of you have traveled far and wide. We hope you continue to do so as part of the New York community, to explore and find solutions at a very fraught time to our ethical challenges in this city. So you have found, I hope, the schedule of events in 2017. We're going to be having a series of workshops and events throughout the year in this hall so that we can use the Sustainable Development Goals as they're meant to be used. They're meant to be used as an inspiration for action. They are not, by the way, simply some kind of technical tool for rich countries to help poor countries. It has nothing to do with that. These are universally agreed principles. principles that are at the disposal of every society, every nation, and every city to find a way to make a more decent life together. And so we're going to spend a year together, and I want you to be here for the year, brainstorming on how we can put these objectives at the center of our city's life. In the program, you'll see we have some really meaty topics to take up. We're going to be taking up the question of ethics on Wall Street. That could take us years, but we're going to do it in one day. We're going to get some of New York City's leaders and Wall Street leaders here, and we're going to have a good discussion about what happened to the ethics. Where are they? How do we recover them? We're going to have, on March 2nd, a discussion with some of the world's leading climate scientists and policymakers on climate change in New York City. This is practical. This is a matter of tens of billions of dollars of investments that we need to make our city safer. It's a matter of our decisions about our energy system in the future so that we are safe for the world. On April 13, we're going to have a discussion about poverty in New York City. Remember, Mayor de Blasio ran his election campaign on a tale of two cities. We have the richest, by far, precincts in the world, and we have some of the poorest places in America right next to them. This city is a city of astounding contrasts. And how we make a city that is inclusive, in which there's opportunity for everybody, in which huge gaps of well-being, of basic healthcare, of basic access to core needs are still not met everywhere in our city, though it's one of the richest places on the planet, will be the topic of April 13. In May, we will have a session on immigration. I think we'll probably be debating that issue in the coming months. In fact, it's obviously going to be one of the most contentious issues that our country is going to be facing. New York City is, of course, one of the fabled homes of migration in modern world history, and we remain that way today, a city of incredible diversity and open doors to migrants. And we're going to talk about the question of migration policy and the challenges of migration in the United States. On June 1, we're going to take up the little topic of corruption in New York politics. There's a little bit of it, by the way. And so we're going to no doubt have a lot of experts here on the subject. Maybe we can learn something about that, about how to break the corruption, which has become so egregious in Albany that sometimes we just have the flow of state officials into prison, out of prison, in the most awful way. On June 29, we're going to have a session on education reform in New York City, because remember, we have some of the best schools in the world, and we have schools that are not meeting even the most basic standards in our city as well. We have some of the most gifted educators in the world. We have Teachers College, which is one of the homes of education thinking for the entire world. What can we learn about education reform? Seems like our new designate Secretary of Education is going to give us something to debate as well. That seems to be a general proposition. This will at least be an interesting time ahead. And then finally, in August or September of 2017, we're going to take up health policy reform, which again is going to be one of the most toughly fought issues. We've been in nonstop debate. We have a health system that is unique in its inequality among the high-income countries. We have a health system that is unique in its cost structure. structure, more expensive than any other place in the world. We also have a health system that is unique in its excellence at the very top range and its innovation. And we have not put the pieces together to make SDG 3, universal health coverage, a reality for our country, much less for the challenge that we face in the whole world. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's what brings us together. We have our work to do. This is brainstorming. This is participation. This is an opportunity to hear from leaders in our city and leaders who are world leaders by virtue of being in this city as we discuss some of the most important, topical, and contentious issues of our time. Please join this series. Please alert your friends. We'll be sending out notices. And thank you all for being here this evening.